Hey my friends, what's going on? I'm back with another video and today we're having a look how to best shoot photos with your GoPro Hero 7 Black. And then in the second part of the video, I'll show you how to edit the GoPro RAW files in Adobe Lightroom. And with that, let's jump right into the video. So let's start by switching over to photo mode just by swiping left, and then let's hit the settings to have a look how to set up our GoPro Hero 7 Black for taking photos. Now what you see here are the default settings, and in our first scenario, if you're a person who wants to get the best photos automatically and you don't want to get bogged down with the settings, I recommend to just go with Super Photo. Depending on the lighting, the movement in your shots or other conditions, Super Photo will choose one of four options: high dynamic range or HDR, local tone mapping, multi-frame noise reduction, or no processing at all if it's not required. While Super Photo doesn't give you any control over the photo, at least with Super Photo you can be assured that the photo that you are getting is usable and you can upload it right away to your social media or share it with friends. The one thing that you can set though is field of view, and the standard field of view of your GoPro is wide, which introduces a fisheye effect or barrel distortion that can be distracting sometimes. In linear mode, the GoPro applies lens correction to the photo, which means it eliminates the barrel distortion or fisheye effect, allowing you to shoot your photos with a straight horizon for a more natural look, which I prefer. If you don't mind the barrel distortion and you prefer the typical GoPro look, you can keep it at wide. So these would be my lazy man settings, but if you want to get more control over the photo, we have to go with ProTune, which gives you access to the advanced controls of the camera. Now as you can see, most of the settings are not available at this point. The reason for it is because Super Photo is still turned on. So let's turn it off because we don't need it. We want to get more control over the photo. So let's have a look at the available settings and what they can do for us. So, shutter speed I usually keep at auto because that gives the GoPro a bit of wiggle room to adjust the exposure to different lighting conditions. This being said though, the GoPro tends to clip the highlights, which is why I set exposure value compensation to -0.5 during the day. In most cases you can keep white balance to auto, but if you want to get a bit more control over the look of your photo, I recommend to adjust the white balance manually. Now just as a tip, in warmer lighting conditions like for instance sunrise, sunset or during the night, I recommend to go with 3000 Kelvin, during daylight 5500 Kelvin, and then in cooler lighting conditions like for instance when it's overcast outside, I recommend to go with 6500 Kelvin. Now let's have a look at the ISO settings, and ISO determines the sensitivity of the sensor to light. The higher the ISO, the more sensitive is the image sensor to light, which means it is better for low light conditions. However, the higher the ISO, also the more noise is being added to the image. So setting the ISO is always a balancing act between the low light capabilities of the camera and how much noise you're willing to accept in your photo. I prefer a rather clean image, so I keep the minimum ISO at 100, but I adjust the maximum ISO based on the lighting conditions I'm in. In bright daylight, I usually go with 200 ISO, in average lighting conditions with 400, and when it's slightly darker outside or I just want to keep it at default levels, I keep the ISO at 800. Now let's scroll down and let's have a look at sharpness. And by default, sharpness is set to high, which in my opinion is way too sharp. It makes the photos look unnatural. Low is slightly too soft, so I prefer medium, which gives us a moderately sharpened image. Now last but not least, let's have a look at the color profile. And since we are adjusting here for JPEGs, I go with GoPro. GoPro gives you an already processed image with nice, vivid, contrasty colors. If you, however, want to do more in post-processing on your phone, for example, you can go with flat. But otherwise, GoPro should be fine. Now, these are the settings if I shoot JPEGs, but still want to have some control over the photo. However, if I want to get full control, which means I don't want the GoPro to process the image, I want to process the image myself in Adobe Lightroom, for example, then I shoot RAW. In RAW, the GoPro saves a minimally processed sensor readout alongside the JPEG, retaining all the image information, which allows for being most flexible in post-processing. And how that looks like, we'll have a look at in just a second. Just in case you don't care much about the JPEG file because you don't intend to use it, you can turn ProTune off because the ProTune settings don't have an effect on the RAW file. So let's have a look how to edit a GoPro RAW image in Adobe Lightroom, and just for demonstration purposes, a random GoPro shot of mine. Just in case you're interested in Adobe Lightroom presets to get these type of one-click edits, there's a link to my presets in the description below. And thanks in advance to anyone who's supporting my channel in that way. Today, however, we are editing this photo from scratch, so let's go back to the original and let's start the editing process. On the right-hand side in Adobe Lightroom, you have all your features and tools, and we start from the top and work our way down to the bottom. So usually I start with setting the white balance of my photo, either by adjusting the temperature and tint slider, or go to the drop-down menu and choose one of the predefined examples. For example, this would be daylight, but in my opinion, it looks too warm, and I was quite happy with how the original one looked, so I just go back to as shot. Next, we can adjust the exposure, and if you want, also the contrast, but quite frankly, the exposure, in my opinion, is alright, so there's no need for any changes here. So we bring down the highlights and then lift the shadows in order to bring back some information in the lighter and darker areas of our photo. Often wise, there's still some information that is being crushed, so we'll try to get that back. And then we keep holding down the Alt key and set the white and black points of our photo. All the white points here means it's pure white, so all the information is being lost, and same for the black points as well. So we want to make sure we are not going overboard and delete too much information of our photo. Since I'm only making subtle adjustments today, I don't really need to double check with the Alt key, but if you do, please make sure you use the Alt key in order to get the best possible results. Now let's have a look at the presence of our photo, and here we can adjust the clarity, dehaze, vibrance, or saturation. And that really depends on your personal taste. Let me make these adjustments real quick and then we can move on. Today I'm going more for a subtle look. This looks good to me. Okay, so let's move on. So the tonal curve allows you to control the lightness and the darkness of the various parts of your photo. The bottom left, we have the shadows. In the upper right, we have the highlights, and everything in the middle are the midtones. And usually I'm going for an S-curve because that gives it a nice contrast. And I also prefer to crush the shadows a little because that gives it an overall vintage, muted look that I really like. So this looks good to me. Just some slight adjustments today. I'd like that subtle look. Looks good. So let's move on. Now the HSL tab is where you get the most fun in Adobe Lightroom. It stands for Hue, Saturation and Luminance, and you can spend hours in this tab. Today I'm just having a look at Hue. Now the Hue sliders allow you to replace colors or hues in your photo with the neighboring colors from the color wheel, which is a lot of fun because it's almost like you can repaint the photo. And then Saturation would allow you to adjust the intensity of a color. And then luminance, the brightness. Again, it would take too long if we go and adjust everything. So I'm just looking at hue here to give this photo an artistic look, and then we can move on. So I think this looks really good. Maybe let's adjust the purple and magenta tones. I think we are good to go. Now with split toning, you can add two different colors to the highlights and shadows of your photo, which gives it a nice effect. Just think of teal and orange, for example, because not only it can look good, it can also increase the tonal contrast of your photo. Nothing that I want to do here in our example today. So let's move on and let's have a look at the details tab. Here, essentially, you can increase sharpness of your photo, just in case you have set sharpening in the GoPro settings to either low or medium. I never go with more than 70 because again it makes the photos look too sharp and that looks unnatural. Maybe adjust the radius slightly as well, but otherwise 70 is absolute maximum for me. Same thing with noise reduction. I never go more than 50 because then details are being lost and the image tends to look dull. So 50 is the absolute maximum if you really need to add noise reduction. But here in our example, I don't need it, so let's move on. Next would be lens correction. In here, Adobe Lightroom offers profiles for a variety of different lenses, also some for GoPros. I barely use them, but what I do here is to remove chromatic aberrations. Under effects, you can add a post-crop vignetting, obviously not a must, but in my opinion, a very nice way to close the image by darkening the corners. So we do this real quick. You could also add grain if you want, but I personally am not a big fan of it, so I barely use it. So next, under the calibration tabs, I usually like to play with the different process versions. Here, version 4, just adjusting the slider a bit can bring out some of the colors and tonal effects that I really want, so I usually play with those. And to be honest, this looks quite nice to me already. And I think we're almost done. Let's scroll up again. Let's have a look at the basic tab because I believe I want to make some slight adjustments, like for instance, increasing the contrast. And then I think the image needs a bit more saturation. So I make these adjustments and then I believe we are good to go. Well, maybe a bit of clarity as well. Just a little bit. Okay. So this is it. I'm really happy with how this photo turned out. It really looks good, and quite frankly, this is a photo that has been shot with a GoPro and not with a DSLR or very expensive mirrorless camera. And for that, in my opinion, the results are really good. Now let's have a look at the original or the unprocessed version, if you will. This is the before. And this is the after. Very nice. So this is it, my friends. This is how to best shoot photos with your GoPro Hero 7 Black and how to edit the photos in Adobe Lightroom. And I hope this video was helpful. If you're interested in my Adobe Lightroom presets, there's a link in the description down below. If you found this video helpful and you want to see more of these type of videos, please like and subscribe and hit that bell icon, still 2018 style. Any questions, any feedback, leave a comment down below and either me or someone else from the community will get back to you. And with that, as always, I'll catch you guys in my next video.